With each other all night long, here to query everything I say, are quick to criticise Jason Manford. Yeah. Constantly quibbling, Aisling B. Quashing all opposition, Anuvab Pal. And, oh, will you be quiet, Alan Davis. Some particularly pugnacious buzzers, Jason goes. Oh, that's horrible, isn't it? Oh. Aisling goes.
Sounds like my. Rewatch it. So sorry. So sorry.
Anuvab goes.
I was hoping the attention wouldn't come to me after that.
And Alan goes.
Oh, yes, it is!
Oh, yes! Wow. The audience are so pleased with themselves, they can't carry on. What happens when you quarrel with the bellower?
Quarrel's one of those things that only English people say.
Why would you not say it? What's wrong?
It's not a word I would use. No, like, it sounds like something like a teacher would say if you'd had a proper fist fight with another kid at school, and then when they got your mum and dad, they were like, I'm afraid Jason and Jamie have had a quarrel.
I'm new to London and I'm beginning to realise that when someone has a dispute or a quarrel, the English language works at two levels.
Yes.
I realised in Britain when someone says to me, Anuvab, I have a slight issue. Yeah. It means I've killed their whole family.
Yeah. I think that is entirely true. OK, so the bellower is the nickname of an actor called James Quin. He was the leading actor in London in the first half of the 18th century.
What has he come as then?
Well, that, apparently, it's him giving his Coriolanus.
Is it really? Yeah.
I think it's more anus than Coriolanus. He was unbelievably quarrelsome, and he actually killed two people in duels and wounded multiple others. He had one of the loudest voices in show business. He also did excessive gesticulation, and he left extremely long pauses. These were all the hallmarks of a great actor. Wow. At that time. So would-be actors were schooled in three different pauses. There was moderate, longer, and grand. And because you're all natural performers, I thought we would see how you would fare on stage in Quinn's era. So we're going to act out what's written on the script cards that you've got on the desk. So Jason and Anuvab, a bit of quarrelling, please, from Titus Andronicus. Very loud, very big gestures.
Yes.
Pausing.
OK, here we go. Villain, what hast thou done?
That, sir, which thou canst not undo.
Thou hast undone our mother.
You do know after that. It's very, very good.
I was taken aback for
yes, no.
Do a pause.
Do a grand pause.
Villain, I have done thy mother.
That's an early your mum joke from Shakespeare.
Oh, I like that.
He invented the word quarrelsome, actually. It's, in fact, the only word he coined beginning with Q. It comes up in As You Like It and in The Taming of the Shrew. Right, Alan and Aisling, I've got an EastEnders-style script for you. I'm actually going to take a small part in this myself.
Oh!
I know. So, you know, big gestures, big pausing. Here we go.
OK.
Oh, Aisling. I remember saying, we're Barney Rubble with me old trouble and strife. She found a pair of your Alan Wickers in my Lucy Lockett.
Alan. You absolute donor. You need to be more careful.
Now, what's this all about?
Stay out of this!
You cow!
You cow, it's you.
Stay out of this, cow. You're not my mum.
Actually... she is.
See that making a comeback as a style. So, Quinn killed two people. The first man he killed was an actor who mispronounced Kato as Keto on stage.
I'm like that with Pacific and specific.
Oh, yeah.
I just take them out long range.
So, Quinn mocked him in front of the audience, and the guy decided to challenge him to a duel, and in fact, he was killed.
He mocked somebody?
Yes.
The other bloke looked like.
He only got done for manslaughter, and that was it. He just went back to work, frankly. He was a notorious womanizer. There's a marvelous story. He once invited a married woman to his boudoir, and then he realized he'd forgotten his key, so he thought, oh, no, I'll take her to a brothel. And anyway, awkwardly, her husband happened to be there. And the husband walked in on them, you know, in flagrante. And in the ensuing fight, Quinn stabbed him in the leg.
One of the funny things that used to happen in British India and during the Empire was there would be a lot of duels among Englishmen for petty things.
Oh, right.
They'd fall in love with someone locally, or it would be over wine or whatever, which is very confusing for the locals because they expected the guns to be pointed at them.
But they're pointing at each other.
Yeah, and I came across some notes between two governor generals who were fighting. And one of the big issues was back then they couldn't get the logistics right. So they said, I'll see you on Thursday. He's like, Thursday, sir, I'm taking my daughter for a walk.
I'm going to kill you Thursday. Can't do Thursday.
We've got five aside.
So one said, look, they went on for 5 years where they couldn't fix a meeting.
I love that. Quinn's big rival at the time was David Garrick, great famous actor.
Oh, David Garrick.
First actor, in fact, to move towards acting rather than shouting.
Where's my glove? Where's my glove? Props!
But they were friends, and Garrick eventually wrote the epitaph that is on Quinn's tomb in Bath Abbey.
That's a Garrick Theatre named after him.
Yeah. I mentioned that James Quinn was handy in a duel, but now let's see how you fare. So, for this question, please start with your hands on your heads. We have changed your buzzers so they all make the same sound. Which of you is the quickest at pressing your buzzer? Go, 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 go! Oh, oh! Was slowest. I'm just going to check with VAR.
Oh, yes.
Get the replay there. Let's just have a quick look. Yeah. OK. And the answer is... Jason. Jason, you were the winner. Oh, there we go. So, very good, but how would a Victorian have done it differently?
Victorian?
Yes. It's whether you think the Victorians would have been quicker. Would they have beaten Jason?
No, I think slower.
Why, darling? Just because it's a long time ago?
Partly. And there's less things to, like, move out of the way off quicker.
You agreeing? You agreeing, Annabelle?
Yes.
I mean,
in that, a technology like a light bulb would need a bunch of chemical reactions and stuff to happen.
OK.
So would they, like, pull on something and a bunch of stuff would happen and a part of the house would explode?
No. OK.
You're thinking of Wallace and Gromit.
Yeah. So here's the thing. We would think maybe that we would be quicker today, but really the Victorians had quicker reactions than we do today.
What?
So in the 1880s and 90s, there was a statistician called Francis Galton. He tested thousands of people to see how quickly they could react to lights and sound. And we have consistently got slower. So on average, about 10% over the past century. And we don't really know why. So possibly modern pollutants have had an effect on our brains. That is a possibility. Possibly... This one I don't like at all. It's because we're taller, is one of the reasons given. So our nerve impulses have got further to travel in our bodies, and so they take longer to get to their destinations. But it does seem to be that the Victorians were a bit faster than us. And do you think boys or girls are faster?
Say girls. I'm going
to say girls. Be careful, Jake.
Sandy. Girls.
It's usually boys. But what they've discovered in the past 40 years or so is that the gap has decreased.
Boys are getting increasingly jumpy.
Yes. Maybe because women are now doing day-to-day things like driving, which they didn't do before.
That's what the boys are getting out of the way of.
Left-handed or right-handed people quicker?
Left-handed people are the devil, so I would say right-handed people, Sandy.
I'm left-handed, so I'm going to say right.
It's left-handed people. You did win.
Of course, I should have used my own experiment.
Yes.
Damn it.
It's probably because most right-handed people are very, very right-handed. In other words, most left-handed people, so yourself included, are more mixed. The two brain hemispheres of the left-handers tend to be more balanced and split to their work more equally.
It's one of the lesser disabilities. Look, I'm not. I don't want everything. Just the blue parking badge. That's all I want.
Left-handed parking base. The right-handed people coming out carrying their phones in the left. No, I'm left-handed.
Just stand there in the supermarket. In the supermarket throwing apples. You caught it with your right hand! You're in the wrong spot!
The first scientist to measure reaction time in laboratory conditions was a Dutch ophthalmologist called Franciscus Donders in 1869. He found that we take 0.1 seconds to physically respond to a sudden noise. So why might that matter that we know that?
Alarms?
No, it's racing, sprinting races. So if you move in less than 0.1 seconds after the gun has gone off, it's a false start because you could possibly have reacted that fast.
Oh.
Actually, Donders made another contribution to our lives. There's a gap between the back of the tongue and the hard palate, and it is known as the space of Donders.
Where was it?
Between the back of the tongue and the hard palate.
Right.
Trying to find it now. It's hard to find. It's really more of a space.
There's nothing there, darling.
No.
There's nothing there at all.
No, darling. That is correct.
I don't want to really know how he ended up finding that.
Now that I know that, I feel like I have someone else's real estate in my mouth.
I know.
You're telling
sign
me?
To let.
Another bloody weekend, that's what I call that.
Quickest reaction time of any animal is the Condylostylus fly, or the long-legged fly. This is an extraordinary creature. You find it mostly in the USA. It takes just 2 milliseconds for this fly to respond to a stimulus. So, say you try to take a picture of it and the flash went off, it would have gone before the picture was actually taken.
How did they get this one?
I'm afraid he's dead, Jason. His reflexes are about 100 times faster than the fastest human reaction times.
Wow.
I know.
Look at its funny hairy legs. Imagine if you just had four massive hairs on your leg. When you shaved your legs, you had to kind of saw it a bit with a brush.
You must come over. Now, nothing is more likely to cause a quarrel than a badly ordered cue. So my question is, what's the best way to board a plane? The people are in the lounge and you want to board them onto the plane. What's the most efficient way of doing that?
Minimised hand baggage, all those wankers who can't be bothered to check their bags and come on like mules, like pack mules, fill up all the overhead lockers with their very important shit. And sit down farting all the way to Malaga. Sorry, what was the question?
There's a lot of bitterness in this, isn't there?
I had a moment on a flight last week, actually, when I was flying from Aberdeen to Shetland, and I was with my tour manager, who's also a big chap, and we sit next to each other, because we're pals, and there was hardly anyone else on the flight. It was only a small plane. And the stewardess came over, and she said, Mr. Manford, Mr. Isaac, she said, would you mind separating and sitting on either side of the plane?
Oh, no. Weight distribution.
Weight distribution?
They're as heavy as a wing.
So he's gonna land like this if it's...
Well, that's what you should have done. We will at the start.
Yeah.
But during the flight, we're gonna set you a series of challenges. Zigzagging about the plane.
Well, that's first time in the history of the world where turbulence is a person.
Yeah.
That's how I'm going to think of you now, as turbulence.
That's me.
By the back row, then the next row, then the next row.
That is
row,
the most like common... That. Yeah, that is the most common way of doing it. It is also the least efficient.
Or in the middle and then fan it out towards the back and the front.
Take the top off the plane. And have them all swarming over the top like that.
So there's an astrophysicist called Dr. Jason Steffen. He made a computer model and then he teamed up with a TV producer to get people to act out boarding planes in various different arrangements. So he compared boarding from the front, from the back, at random, and what he called Wilma boarding, which is window, middle, and then aisle. Nice. Block boarding, by far the slowest. That's the way the airlines currently do it. So they say this group of seats and then the next group of seats. The absolute best way to do it is board first the even-numbered window seats, followed by the odd-numbered window seats, then repeat with the middle seats, and then repeat with the aisle seats. It's rather complicated. And so he actually recommends just board at random. That would still be much faster than what we currently do.
You don't want too random, do you? You don't want to be on, like, 16 rows back and the pilot's there.
I was boarding recently and this lady announced, "We are boarding everyone not in zone F." And then she said, "And also not in zone A, B, C, D, E." Then she paused and said, "We're just not boarding."
I think there's two types of passengers. They're the ones who think that if anything happened to the pilot, they could probably be all right if they took over and got talked in.
Yeah, that's me.
And there's the other ones who would think there's no way they could do that.
I sort of fancy myself being able to fly a plane. You're right. I think I could bloody give it a go.
But don't you think that when you've watched a load of ER, for example, that you think,
yeah,
I totally could do that heart surgery?
I sort of feel like I'd be naturally good in emergencies. Like, I can't speak Spanish now, but I feel like if there was an emergency, I probably could give it a go.
Yeah. What kind of emergency suddenly requires Spanish?
I feel like the Spanish girl, Sandy. She's come in, she's choking. No one else in the hospital speaks Spanish.
Right.
Something's wrong with her.
Yeah.
She can mime, but we're not getting it.
No.
They haven't trained like me in the dramatic art of mime.
Of course.
And so she's like, paella, Boris Amaredo. Madrid, Venezuela. And I'm like, don't worry. Penicillin. And then it'll just be like that for...
That poor child is dying and you're the last thing she sees. here's a randy scandy fact. There's another queuing study from the fine country of Denmark. Economists concluded the very best method of serving a queue is to serve the last person first. So, when you have a first-in, first-out system, it encourages people to queue. Mm. If the last person got served, nobody would start to stand in the queue because there'd be no point in it. Queues just cause backlog, and so it's much better to serve the last person first.
The way different people queue, you know, around the world can lead to problems. I had a friend of mine recently in Manchester, went to use a cash machine. When he got there to the cash machine, there was a man already using the machine, and 6 foot behind the man, there was a woman sort of waiting her turn. So he says, "Are you in the queue for the cash machine?" And she says, "I'm Nigerian, and my religious beliefs are that because I don't know this man and we're not related, this is the distance that I feel safe and respectful, you know, to what I believe in." Mm. So, because Steve's a very thoughtful person, he then stands 6 foot away from her, you know. It's like a 12-foot, three-person queue out of nowhere. Then the man moved, and the woman moved to the machine to do her money business. Steve then stayed the 6 foot behind.
Perfectly nice.
And he was in his sort of little daydream, and another man came over and said, "You in the queue for the cash machine?" And Steve went to explain, but not loaded with all the information, said, "I am, yeah, but I'm standing here because she's Nigerian."
It's a minefield!
Even when you're trying to be nice!
So, anyway, why might you put a mirror next to a lift? Any thoughts about this? We're talking about waiting.
Next to a lift or in a lift?
No, next to it. It's to do with you looking at yourself. People dislike waiting in line, but they do like looking at themselves. People don't complain if the lift takes a long time to arrive, if they can constantly see themselves. I love this picture, though. So we had an experiment to see if we could recreate this with all of you. So let's have a look. Are we able to do that? There. What do you think? I know!
Oh, it's Top of the Pops from the 70s.
Love it. brilliant.
That's really good fun.
Wow. can we do like the swimming thing where we go?
That's great.
This is
brilliant.
Beginning to look like a Bollywood movie.
Just keeps going after you finish.
Do you know what I did there? I actually tried to catch myself. Oh, yeah, yeah. You have me.
It's like synchronized swimming on your own.
Brilliant.
Yeah, very good. Our queuing advice is to really rile people up by ignoring the instructions at an airport and standing on the left of an underground escalator. That's really upset
you. No.
That's the only thing
I care about after Brexit.
Yeah.
Well, that's only down here that's a problem.
That is London.
It's only London. Yeah. It's not even questioned anywhere else. Stand wherever you want.
You stand wherever you want?
Yeah, it's not a thing. Just a thing down here.
Stand on the right.
Not in anywhere else.
Fucking stand on the right.
Right. Who's famous for generating about 25,000 quarrels a year?
Piers Morgan. You don't have to say it.
Who's
Donald
that?
Donald Trump.
What? Donald Trump, yes.
Oh. You got another one?
Yeah. Katie Hopkins.
You're doing well. That's the three. Yeah.
What might a quarrel be? It's a thing rather than it's a dispute? It's
like a vase of some sort.
Why do you think it's a vase? It's a lovely idea. Why do you think that?
I have no idea what it's
Is it a hat?
No. So...
So it's not a vase and it's not a hat. You haven't left us as much, Sandy.
We are going to go back in time. So between the 10th and the 15th century, what was the principal weapon of war, do you suppose?
Stink bombs.
The plague.
No, the crossbow. And the bolt for a crossbow is called a quarrel.
Oh.
And there was a man called John Malamont, and he was England's chief quarrel maker in the 13th century. He made up to 100 a day, so he made about 25,000 quarrels per year. And the earliest crossbows, I mean, this is a sort of an image of one of the earliest ones. They were really, really difficult to operate because it was so tight to pull it back. So you had to get on your back, use the strength of both legs, your back and your arms, in order to pull the mechanism backwards. Then eventually they invented something called the crossbow stirrup, which meant you could put your foot in the thing and then pull backwards.
That looks like he can bat fire pretty badly. That feels like before the adverts on You've Been Framed. Harry Hill's like, what's going to happen after the break?
Can I ask you, Sandy, weren't there female crossbow people who used to chop off their
bats? You're thinking of bows and arrows, and you're thinking of the Amazons who allegedly cut off their left breast in order to make it easier. Actually, it depends on which... Yeah. You'd cut off your right breast so that the...
You'd be annoyed if you cut off the wrong breast.
Yes, I know.
Joking.
Oh, yeah. No. I was looking in the mirror.
It must have been really odd for them when cannons and bullets came about.
This is the thing. What happened was guns superseded crossbows in warfare, so you're talking about the 16th century, and eventually crossbows became reserved just for recreational use.
I bet when guns come out, there were some pretty annoyed one-titted women knocking about. Chopped off my tit for this!
In the end, it just became a sort of an entertainment thing. There'd be a procession, would be led by a paddle master. He was like sort of, you know, the ringmaster of the thing. But he would punish anybody who shot extremely badly by spanking them with his paddle.
Oh.
So a crossbow is essentially a horizontal and more refined version of the bow and arrow, which brings us to another cue, quivers. Where did Robin Hood keep his quiver?
On his back. In the quiver, the thing you keep your arrows in?
It is the thing you keep your arrows in, but if Robin Hood existed, he would never, ever have pulled arrows from his back.
But you didn't realise there's a photograph of him on the screen.
I'm going to go with that Kevin Costner. When he played Robin Hood, he went from Dover to Nottingham via Hadrian's Wall, so he's probably not the best person to ask anything. The quiver, so it is the sack that you keep the arrows in, but it was stored on the belt. The only people that we know for sure wore it on their backs were Native Americans. There's one odd exception to this. There's a single archer in the Bayeux tapestry who has the quiver on the back. There you can see it, top left there. Oh, yeah.
So here we are. We're saying that they don't have the quiver on the back apart from 50 million Native Americans and people at the Battle of Hastings. Otherwise, there's no evidence.
Except, darling, if you took this as the correct thing, all of those people have got their arrows on the wrong side of the bow, so it would immediately fall off. So I'm going to suggest to you the person doing the sewing was not worried about technical detail. Yeah.
So, Sandy, do you think this photograph was staged?
Yeah, just stand still. OK, I'm nearly there. Nearly got you. Now, what causes quarrels in the Batcave?
Oh. Oh, is it his parking when he comes back in after a fight? Maybe that.
I used to love that show.
It was great.
Oh, it was wonderful. I didn't realise till quite late in my childhood that it was a spoof. Absolutely, seriously.
I didn't know until now it was a spoof. It was a spoof.
Well, they were playing for laughs.
So, I'm not talking about...
Okay, are you talking about actual bats?
Actual bats.
Oh, you've fooled us with the photograph.
All right.
Is it hanging space? Not enough hanging space? Someone putting the light on in the middle of the night? That was...
Right, Alan, because it is almost exactly the stuff that we all fight about. So, researchers recently translated the calls and squeals of bats. They played them to a computer with a machine learning algorithm, and they figured out the patterns in the noises and worked out what the sounds meant. And mostly, bats are complaining, OK? So, most bat squeaks fell into four categories: arguing about who should get what food, arguing about who should sleep where. The females, what were they complaining
cold,
about?
They're cold. No. The men are too hot.
Unwanted male advances is what the females were arguing about. And bats of either sex arguing because they think another bat is sitting too close to them.
If you could improve one of your senses really, really a lot and maybe lose a bit on the others, what would you have?
I'd lose a bit of hearing.
Hearing?
I'd lose a little...
I'm thinking bats, right? They can't see anything, but they can hear everything, which is probably what they're complaining about. I think sight. I'd like sight.
Yeah. Like, I'm getting laser eye surgery in a couple of weeks.
Are you?
Like, well, my eyes are fine, but I'd love if they had lasers in them.
The other fascinating thing about bats is they have multiple different dialects, and they learn them from their mothers and from their peers. They use different tones of voice when they're speaking to different members of their group, and it's one of the only animals to do this. I mean, humans do it, and dolphins do it, and monkeys, but it's very, very rare. And they can actually single out a single bat in the cave to communicate with. And bearing in mind, in some caves, there are 20 million bats. And when they're annoyed, what do? They raise their voices. So, what the bat signal is really saying is get away from me and don't touch my food. This next question is so controversial that Brazil and France almost went to war over it. How do lobsters get about?
Yes, sir. Oyster card.
I know, right?
What can I do?
So, what do you reckon? How do they get about? Yeah.
By black crab.
What do you reckon?
Do they just walk?
So it depends which side you're on. Brazil and France, they very nearly went to war over this. 1961, and the question was, do lobsters crawl or do they swim? So Brazilian law stated that all sea creatures that walked within certain distances of their seashore were exclusively theirs, but anything swimming was fair game. So the French came along, they found a nice spot to catch lobsters, and Brazil claimed that the lobsters were crawling along the coastal shelf, so they belonged to Brazil. France said they were swimming and therefore belonged to the fishermen who were catching them. In actual fact, lobsters mostly walk, but they do swim occasionally. There was a Brazilian Navy oceanography expert. He argued that if lobsters can be considered fish when they swim, so could a kangaroo considered to be a bird when it hops. very interesting. Anyway, tensions escalated.
Wow.
Brazil sent an aircraft carrier. France sent a warship. I mean, there's
the Brazilians, they're coming here, giving it all out.
You've all got lobsters, if you want to take them out. You've all got lobsters. Did you know that lobsters are left and right clawed in the same proportion that we're left and right handed?
Wow. Yeah, so, yeah, I did know that.
So if you look at that one in the picture, it's clearly left clawed. And 10% of lobsters are dominant on the left claw, exactly the same proportions.
So some of them are left-handed and some of them are right-handed?
Yeah, well, it's 10%, exactly the same as...
But they use a right claw when they want to make it feel like it's someone else.
There's a long history of sea life causing international conflict. There's a turbot war, Canada and Spain, the crab war, North and South Korea, the oyster war, mackerel and cod wars, the prawn war, the squid war, the scallop conflict. Here's my favourite, the sprat spat. Latvia and Russia. Look at them all. They're a fantastic list of wars.
God, what a terrible way to get your medals. Like, no one would really respect you if you were like,
yeah, no, I was in the scallop conflict of 1970. I've never really gotten over it, you know.
And showing off as well. Like crustaceans sitting around saying, my grandfather fought in the first prawn war.
Right, lobsters away. How do you get a Dane fired up?
You tell them the end of the crime thriller series?
Yes, who did it? There's a lot of dead people in Copenhagen, aren't there?
Yeah.
Vikings settling quarrels, how might they do it?
Well, it's not with a quiet chat.
No.
Is it?
So the fired-up part is really important.
Do they make their weapons hot?
It's called skin pulling. There's a Nordic spin on tug-of-war. And what you do is you get an animal hide, so walrus, seal or ox or something, and you use it as a rope, and the complainants pull at either end until one is yanked over. Here is the Scandi twist. Right. The whole thing happens over a fire. So whoever loses is dragged into the fire.
We used to do that at the Scouts.
So one of the sagas, there's a king, Yngvi, and he instructs the two opponents, Hastigi and Hjord, to a skin-pulling contest. And Hastigi gets naked, but he thinks that's going to give him some advantage, but he's eventually pulled into the fire, and the king regrets the whole thing. I mean, it's a horrible way of settling a war, isn't it?
Yeah.
The one I like is from 18th century Arabia. There was a Scottish traveller called James Bruce, so 1730 to 1794, and he reported on a town called Yanbu, so present-day Saudi Arabia. And the locals have been fighting for days, wasting the town's ammunition, all firing at each other. And in the end, to agree on how to end the conflict, they all agreed that everything that had happened that was bad was the work of one camel. So they seized the camel, they put it on trial, and they spent the whole afternoon shouting at it, and then speared it and killed it, and that was the end. Yeah, justice was done. And now it's time for the hostile interrogation that we call General Ignorance, Fingers on Buzzers, Please. What's the most dangerous part of this ship? Yes.
The buffet.
So you can see it. You can see it in this picture.
The lifeboat.
It is the lifeboats. You're absolutely right.
They're the most dangerous bit.
Yeah. So there was a safety study carried out by the Marine Accident Investigation Branch in 2001, and lifeboats killed more people than they saved in the UK and Australia over a 10-year period. In fact, they found it was the most common cause of death on board ship. It accounts for 16% of all lives lost. Almost all of the accidents happened during training or maintenance. And in the same time period, no lifeboat was actually used in an evacuation, so they didn't save any lives whatsoever. It is considered a really serious problem. Airplanes have a similar issue with their apparently life-saving devices. In fact, we can try them out now. We're about to crash land on water. Fortunately, your life jacket is under your seat, and since we know you always pay attention in the safety demonstrations, here we go. Brace, brace, brace. Find your... Go, go, find your life jacket. Find your life jacket.
Toggle.
Stick it on. Inflate it. Bring it out. Very good. As far as we can ascertain, life jackets have never saved anybody's life on a modern commercial airline.
I feel like I overreacted then, if I'm honest.
So you're going to take them off, so if you just take them. Can you get them off? No.
I feel like. No!
Do you remember when that plane crash land on the Hudson?
Famous? I do, yeah.
Oh, when Tom Hanks was in the plane.
Yes. Only 33 of the 150 passengers who were on board had even managed to get hold of their life vests. And of those 33 who'd managed to find them, only 4 were wearing them correctly. They're only intended for planned water landings. In other words, when there's been advanced warning. And that hasn't happened for several decades. There's
well, I often wonder that when I'm flying Heathrow to Edinburgh, they give it all that. I think, well, that'd be a good shot, mate. Where are you going to...? Right into Windermere. Yeah.
There's a woman called Cynthia McLean. She's the Federal Aviation Authority's principal cabin safety investigator. She says the best advice is leave the bloody life vest behind. It takes too long. And actually, the best thing you can do if you land on the water is get off the plane. So they could save an enormous amount of weight, airlines, if they just removed the almost useless life jackets. You save about 1 million gallons of fuel every year, but they don't do it. Why don't they do it?
Psychological comfort.
Yeah, we get psychological comfort from knowing there's a life jacket.
Why don't they replace them with parachutes? I've never understood that.
But if people can't put the life jacket on properly, who the heck is going to manage?
Why can't the plane be equipped with 2 enormous parachutes?
Yes.
So when it's going down, they just release the 2 enormous parachutes and it floats to the...
Yeah, like Wile E. Coyote.
When you jump off a plane, you're strapped to another human being, right? When you're, like...
I mean, when you do sky jumping?
Sky jumping, yeah.
Oh,
it'd be
okay.
Quite good if every seat there was already someone sitting. You were strapped into them. And then, in the event of an emergency, you jump with them.
No, I do not want to spend any flight, no matter how short, strapped to somebody else.
I do.
Right, moving on. Where did the Great Fire of London start?
Ooh. Go on, then. You think you know. Go on.
Let the audience get it.
Go on, then.
Put it away. Yes! It's not nice, is it? It's not nice. Makes you feel stupid, doesn't it?
At the monument.
So, well, closer to the monument than we thought. So it did start at a bakery. There was a baker called Thomas Farriner, and he left his fuel out too close to the oven. But they've now discovered planning documents from 1673. There was an academic called Dorian Gerhold, and he revealed that the oven was actually situated on Monument Street. So it's about 60 feet east of Pudding Lane. And, of course, Monument Street wasn't called that then because...
There was no monument.
There was no monument.
Yes.
So the monument was built in 1677. Now, the thing about the monument is it's 202 feet tall because it was supposed to be 202 feet from where the fire started, but it's probably now too tall because it probably started much closer to the monument. What happened was there were lots of printers in the area and stationers and booksellers and so on, and they wanted to save all their paper, and they rushed to the vaults of St Paul's because they thought the thick walls would keep it safe. In fact, this vast amount of paper just became kindling, helped the fire spread, it destroyed the cathedral. Apparently, it was a gruesome sight. The collapse of St Paul's exposed corpses of people who'd been buried for hundreds of years. And the fire smouldered for 6 months.
God.
Destroyed 13,200 houses and 87 churches. And if you imagine the time, London, the most densely populated urban settlement in the world, how many people do you think died?
It's really low. It's about 5 or something.
So it was mentioned on QI on the D series that everybody thought it was very low, that maybe it was 5 or 6 people. They now question this. It's almost certain that it was hundreds of people who perished. The real problem is the deaths of the poor and even the middle class. Nobody's that bothered, so it goes probably unreported.
How many people were living in London at the time? Was it, like, a big place?
About 500,000 people living in London at the time.
Oh, OK.
But some people so burnt that you wouldn't know even that there was a body there.
Yeah.
And also, for 3 weeks after the fire started, the Bills of Mortality, which was the record of London deaths, went unpublished because the press itself getting burnt down. Right, moving on. The Great Fire of London didn't start on Pudding Lane. It started just next door. How should you position your hands when holding the steering wheel?
10 to 2.
Me. Not anymore. Why not? We're no longer recommended.
Well, it's definitely not that.
Something has changed in cars since the origins of the 10-to-2 idea. What has changed in the actual development of cars? No, not seatbelts. It's what? Airbags is absolutely right. So if your hands are too close together, which is the 10 and the 2, it increases the risk of injury, and some of the injuries are horrific. Airbags inflate at up to 250 miles per hour.
Jesus.
Broken hands, entire hands, sometimes requiring amputations. There is a really stomach-churning injury called degloving.
What?
Yeah, very
so
good.
So lifeboats, airbags. Like, what is... What, the paramedics just come round and slit your throat? Like, what's...
The best thing is like that, 9 and 3, because that way the airbag has got space to come up between your hands. Keeps you out of the way.
I just stay with my cup. Just loop it round once. Yeah.
The British driving test changed in 2018. What did they get rid of?
Oh, that's good. I failed my theory test 3 times last year.
Have you passed now?
No, she hasn't. I do believe I'm just too much of a genius to grasp something so simple. That's my
theory. I failed the practical 6 times.
What did they pull you up on?
I got to a junction. I looked right. I said, all right, your side.
I failed my test because when I was meant to go forwards, I went backwards.
They got rid of the turn in the road manoeuvre. That's gone, and that reversing around the corner is gone as well.
Yeah, now, good, that was hard.
Is that because that's creepy?
I also think parallel parking should do one. Because that's why we're so fat, because we keep trying to park closest to the place we need to be. But if you actually just find the nearest, like, easy parking space, sometimes you're 2 miles away.
Yeah. there's a wonderful survey they did in 2015 of the most common reasons people fail their tests. Unusual reasons for failing included, I thought a line of parked cars was a line of traffic, so waited behind it. I went too far forward at a zebra crossing and bumped the bumper on a pedestrian. And then argued it wasn't my fault as his outfit had made him blend in with the stripes. A good-looking man on a motorbike caught my attention and, without realising, I started to drive directly towards him. The instructor had to enforce an emergency stop because I nearly crashed straight into him.
Driving instructors, just as a type of people, are quite mean. Mm. I was getting my driving test, I sat down, he looked at me and he said, I don't think you're going to make it.
Wow.
Wow, at least he wasn't a doctor. What's the definition of a species?
Type of a living thing?
A class of animal?
Well, here's the thing, there is no universal definition of a species.
Type of a living thing it is, then.
There's certainly at least 32 different definitions. So one of the things that people learn, if they're 2 different species, they can't produce viable offspring. So, for example, mules, which are horse-donkey hybrids, horses have 64 chromosomes, donkeys have 62, so mules end up with 63, which is an odd number, can't divide evenly into sperm and eggs, and so it's sterile. Mm. But it is not the case with different species combinations. So bonobos and chimps successfully interbreed, and zoologists estimate 88% of all fish species could happily interbreed. Quite a few fish species, like the swordtails in Mexico, are the result of 2 different fish species.
What about human and chimp? Asking for a friend.
Species can successfully breed with one another, although it is admittedly very hard to make a whale have sex with an oak tree. And with that questionable image in your minds, it's time for the scores. Well and truly quashed in last place with minus 37. It's Alan! In fourth place with minus 25, Jason! Place with minus 17, Aisling. In second place with minus 9's the audience. And our winner today with a full 4 points, Anuvab. Leaves me to thank Anuvab, Aisling, Jason and Alan, and I leave you with this quick quotation from the quarrelsome Elizabeth Gaskell. I'll not listen to reason. Reason always means what someone else has got to say. Good night. Yeah.